Patthana. So we'll just will continue from where we left.
Sure.
So maybe you have some.
If I will have some questions, I will ask.
And you can send her the link so that she can see
the past videos.
Past videos. Then you can be in sync because we've already gone quite a bit ahead.
Okay.
And so we have Garima Deepti, Shilesh and Sudhakar online.
So good morning, friends. And we'll start with meditation. Today we have taken this Triratan Vandana, so I think we'll do that starting in. And then followed by that, we'll do the meditation. Namo bhagavato arahato इतिपिसो भगवा अरहं सम्मा संबुद्धो. I think we know the translation of it because we have been listening to it long, so I'll not read the translation then. Vidya charana sampanno, we can join it. Vidya charana sampanno सुरतो लोकविदु अनुत्तरो पुरुषधम्मसारथि सत्ता देव मनुस्सानं बुद्धो भगवाति स्वाख्यातो भगवता धम्मो संदिट्ठिको अकालिको एहिपश्यिको उपनेको पच्चत्तं वेदितंबु विन्योहिति सुपटिपन्नो भगवतो सावक संघो उजुपटिपन्नो भगवतो सावक संघो न्यायपटिपन्नो भगवतो सावक संघो सामीचि पटिपन्नो भगवतो सावक संघो यदिदं चत्तारि पुरिस युगानि अट्ठ पुरिस पुंगला ईसु भगवतो सावक संघो आहुनेय पाहुनेय दक्षिणेय अंजलि करणीय अनत्तरं पुण्यकीर्तन लोकसाते. स्थिति में शरणं बुद्धो मे शरणं एतेन सच वदेन भवतु मे जयमङ्गलम् नति मे शरणं धम्मो मे शरणं एतेन सच वदेन भवतु ते जयमङ्गलम् नति मे शरणं संघो मे शरणं एतेन सच वदेन भवतु सर्वमङ्गलम्। We will now study this chapter, Sutta Nipata 4.7, Tissamettiya Suttam. I have written down the story behind it from the commentary. It says that Tissa and Mettiya were two associates who happened to have heard the teachings of Dhamma by the Buddha while they later were residing at Jetavana in Savatthi. Realizing that they could not be able to put teaching to practice, both of them asked for ordination and they became monks. And their teachers gave them the appropriate kamatthana and then they began to go to practice in the forest. Now out of them Mettiya went, but Tissa was little tarrying, and so he went left behind saying that he would long to listen to more teachings of Buddha. But as it happened, when he went to his village to get the alms, the female folks there, they seduced him and eventually he disrobed. So Mettiya, on the other hand, attained arhatship. And when the vasa was over, he arrived at Savatthi to pay homage to the Buddha. And in due course, the Buddha was accompanied by Mettiya, reached the place where the former monk Tissa was there. And then the monk Mettiya requested Buddha to say a few words about how one gets carried over by the sexual fantasies, and that's how this discourse came up. So it's a discourse addressed to people who disrobe after becoming a monk, basically. So we'll start reading out. मेथुना मनु उत्तस्य विघातं ब्रूहि मारिसा सुत्वानतं शासनं विवेके Sikhis Samasi. So the Marisa is the, you know, adjective used for the Lord also. He says, tell me, Vigatam Bruhi. So Bruhi Marisa means, please speak, tell to me, O Lord. When this is said by the Maitreya. The one who is given to sex, what are the difficulties faced by him? Please tell us, so that Viveke Sikhi Samase, so that we can, hearing the instructions, we'll then be motivated to walk in seclusion. So he's trying to get advice from Buddha, so that his friend Tissa can be motivated to become a monk again. Mithuna manyutasya musate vapi sasanam michcha cha patipajyati etam tasmi anariyam. Says the person who is given to sex, all his precepts are lost. A monk who is given to that is lost, and he, in fact, michcha cha patipajyati, walks on the wrong path, etam tasmi anariyam. This is what is ignoble in him. So you can read now. Third.
Eko pubbe charitvana mehunam yo nisveti yanam mantam vatam loke na mahu puttu janam.
Eko pubbe charitvana means one who has been earlier, previously, dwelling alone, wandering alone. Metuyanam yo nisevati, who then gives himself to sex. Yanam bhantam vatam loke hinam ahu puthujanam. The common folk, puthujanam is the common folk, they call him a lowly person. Like yanam bhantam vatam loke, just like a carriage which is swerving and lurching on the path. Fourth apadu.
Yasu kitti jaya pubbe aeti vapi tassasa itamapi disva sikhi tha methunam vipa hatavi.
Vipahatave. Yasho kirti chayapubbe. Yash or kirti, jo uski purani hoti hai. So whatever honor and renown he has, hayate vapitasa, that is high ho jati, that is lost. Etam pi disva sikheta. So having seen this, methunam vipahatave, let him give up the sex. So a person who has been a monk and gets caught in that, he should see that as a result of it, his respect is gone, and therefore he should give it up. Read the next.
Sankapihi pareto so kapano viya jayati sutva parisam vighusam manaku hoti tathavidam.
Sankapihi, to uske sankalp pareto so, is over kapano viya jayati, is overcome by his thoughts. And kapano means a poor person or like a miserable fellow, he lives, he broods on them. Jhayati, bhyayati actually means dhyan karta hai. Here it means he broods on them. Sutva paresam nighosam. And having heard the dusron ki paresham or dusron ki nighosam, having heard the reproach of others, manku hoti tathavida, he becomes very distressed and downcast. अथ सत्थानि कुरुते परवादेहि चोदितो एष ख्वास महागेधो मोसवज्जं पगाहति. सो अथ सत्थानि, सत्थानि शस्त्र कहते हैं, बट हियर इट मीन्स द रॉन्ग एक्शंस. कुरुते परवादेहि चोदितो, इज टॉर्मेंटेड बाय द वर्ड्स ऑफ अदर्स, देन दे रिप्रूव अदर्स, इन रिप्रूव हिम एंड ही देयर बिकॉज ही कमिट्स इविल डीड्स. Es khasa mahagetho, he becomes deeply attached, mosavajjam pagahati, and sinks into falsehood.
Panditoti samanyato eka charyam अडितितो अथपि मिथुन युद्धो मंदोवा परी किसलेत किसलसति
पंडितोति समन्यतत समन्यात। व्हेन ही हैड एंटर्ड अपॉन द समना पाथ ही वाज कॉल्ड एज पंडित, ही वाज थॉट एज ए वाइज पर्सन। एक चरियम अडितितो एंड ही हैड decided that he will dwell alone, he was then called as a wise person by people. Athapi methuno yuto, and when he has taken up the householder's life and given to sex, mando va parikilisadi, he is being considered as a fool by the same people.
Adi
Navam
पितामादीनवम नत्वा मुनि उपे परि इदा इकाचर्यम दलहम आयिरा आनिसवेता मेथुनम।
एतम आदिनवम ज्ञात्वा, दिस आदिनम नो डेंजर, ज्ञात्वा नोन, हैविंग नोन दिस डेंजर, मुनि पुब्बा परे इदा, फ्रॉम द Pubba means earlier to the end, that is from the beginning to the end, having known this danger. Ekacharyam dalham kaira, let one dwell, let a sage dwells in a solitary life, then he save etha methuram and not give up himself to sex and become a householder.
Veka naves sikhita etada aryanam uttamam na tena sethu manetha manetha सावे निबाना संतिके।
विवेक मीन्स सेक्लूजन, विवेकन्या वा सिक्खेता, लेट हिम लर्न द सेक्लूजन। एतद् अरियम उत्तमम, बिकॉज दिस इज द हाईएस्ट फॉर द नोबल पर्सन। न तेन सेठो मन्नेथा, देन दे आर नॉट, ही इज नॉट कंसिडर्ड द हिमसेल्फ सेठो मन्नेथा, बिकॉज जस्ट बिकॉज ही इज लिविंग इन solitary life, he should not consider himself the श्रेष्ठ, that he is the best. Save Nibbana Sant, even though he is very near the Nibbana. So he's pointing out that don't make a big issue out of seclusion also and take it as a personal achievement. Rittasya Munino Charato Kamesu Anapekhino Ogatinnasya Pihayanti Kamesu Gaditapaja. Rittasya Munino Charto. Rittasya means rikt, void, void of desires here. So a muni who dwells void of any desire, kameshu anapekhino, who is not coveting the sensual pleasures, ovatinnas pihayanti. Ova means the flood, so he has crossed the stream of desires, kameshu gadita paja. The people, praja means praja, jo kamanao mein gajita, who is the people who are lived in, who was kind of enveloped by the sensual desires, they pihayanti, they kind of envy him. So a person who is free from desires and does not covet the sensual pleasures and who has crossed the stream, the common people who are entrenched in desires, they envy him. So this was the short discourse which the Lord gave, and as the story says, on hearing it, the Tissa was motivated again to become a monk. He attained Sotapatti and became a monk, and eventually attained Arhantsup. So this was a discourse actually for people who have disrobed after becoming a monk, and most of them disrobe because of this very reason, that they get attracted by some person and revert to the householder's life. So this is a specifically addressed to that situation. Any comments or queries? We can take that.
Any questions? Silesh, Sudhakar is typing something, so we can read. If today's sannyasi hear the same words, would they become sotapanna?
If they hear it from Buddha, very likely.
Yeah, I was going to ask the same, that how come almost all the suttas that I read, when Buddha says some words, then most it ends that the person attained sotapanna.
See, the field in which they are listening has a very important influence. We often neglect it. Isn't it?
Right.
When we meditate in a proper place, in the center, we get a different level of insight than when we do it otherwise.
But a person must also have done, has also have attained some mental perfection to be able to reach that shodhapan.
Yeah,
it cannot
definitely.
Be only because
definitely.
Of the field, right?
Definitely. Definitely. The past paramis must be there. Definitely.
So then also it is possible to get slipped into this sensual desire.
Yeah, see. Even after having become monks, so many, even in modern time, we see that happening. And there's no wonder that it is happening now, because it was happening even then. Even at the time of Buddha, it must have been happening. So, no wonder it is happening even today. Once you enter the stream, but even householders can become shrutapanna. So, it's not necessary that one should be a monk to become a
shrutapanna.
But the impact of Buddha's presence is undeniable. Anath Pindak, we know stories about so many things. Even Vishakha was a shrutapanna at a young age, 7 or 8. And then she married. She had children. So it's not that it is debarred, but it is meant for people as a, those once you have become a monk, then to disrobe is a very unfortunate event.
Yeah.
Really. But this is happening, must have happened then. That's how this discourse arose.
So Sudhakar has a question, sir. Does a sotapanna know that he is one that realizes it?
No. Hmm? Only the arhant knows. That is the big if. That only the arhant can know that he has become an arhant. So before that, one can have a, from visual experience, one can say that he has become less attached. That's why. You know, Ajahn-Chah and others say the fruition is absence of grasping. So the key test which we can apply is to what extent we are able to grasp onto the world. You know, you remember that crisp statement. Sabbe dhamma nalam abhinivesas. So this is the essence of my teaching, that nothing whatsoever should be grasped as me or mine, myself. So the extent to which we are able to give up this grasping, to that extent we are free. And this is one of our own personal experience. But
trying to find out
is not...
Is again trying to be grasping.
Grasping. So when it happens naturally, and the suttas mention only for arhants, that they realize that this is the last life and all the asvas have been...
So it may happen that while after the Buddha had given the discourse, Buddha comes to know about that person.
Yeah, Buddha would definitely know. For example, in Dhamma Chakkappavattana Sutta, you know, we hear Buddha mentioning that Kundanya has got the insight. He mentioned it. He had become only sotapanna, not an arhant and that. So Kundanya didn't know. It's only after the Anatta Lakkhana Sutta that they all became arhants. And then they knew.
In fact, Buddha would go and give the suttas because he knew that people are ready to attain that state.
That's right.
Sotapan ki jo sthiti hai, wo bahut tez jaldi aa sakti hai, mujhe lagta hai. Jyada samay nahi lagta usko.
It depends, no, how we are practicing. हमारी कितनी पारमी है, कितने हमारे संकल्प दृढ़ है,
ज्यादा दूरी दूर नहीं है सोतापन
बनना। ऑफकोर्स अरहंत तो बहुत दूर है, नो डाउट अबाउट इट।
लेकिन बट सोतापन,
इवन सोतापन इज क्वाइट, आई मीन इफ वन कैन, एज बुद्धा सेज, नो इफ यू कैन बिकम एंटर दिस स्ट्रीम, योर सफरिंग इज रिड्यूस्ड टू एब्सोल्यूटली मिनिमम। यू नो, गिव दैट एग्जाम्पल दैट he puts up some dust from the earth on his fingernails and he says, how much dust you see on my fingernails? So it's very little. How does it compare with the dust of the whole earth? It's insignificant. So similarly, one who has entered the stream, his suffering is like the dust on my nails, and that of others is like the whole earth. So there's a huge difference in that.
And Sir Sudhakar had the additional question, which doubt gets uprooted in him, possibly at the Sotapanna stage?
Sakkaya Ditti is the key thing. Three fetters get removed. First is Sakkaya Ditti, that is the attachment to body-mind complex as me, as I. Not that the I notion fully completely ends. The notion that I am still remains, but I am not the body, I am not the mind, that becomes absolutely clear. That is the key thing.
Yeah.
Then others which follow directly are the absence of attachment to rites and rituals and any doubt about the path.
Okay.
These are the first three fetters. Then the other fetters, because these are the fetters which we have created. Others are carried along the stream of consciousness for a long time, you know, craving, aversion, and conceit, and agitation. There are deeper mental factors which take time to get out.
So,
बस ठीक है, वो थोड़ी देर में पहुँच जाएगी, हीट विल रीच देयर, दिस इज स्टार्ट।
एंड सर देयर आर फॉलो अप क्वेश्चंस हियर। ग्रैस्पिंग इज देयर अंटिल ईगो एग्जिस्ट इन इट, that is fetter of Sakkaya Ditti is there until Sotapanna.
Yeah, that is true. But mana remains, you know, that's a very subtle thing. You know? The feeling that I am still remains. And that ends only at the arhat stage.
Sotapanna rehta I am.
But ye clear hota hai ki sharir main nahi hu, theek hai. If the body is dying, decaying, it's not okay, not a big deal.
So, Silesh is further asking, isn't I am Sakkaya Ditti?
I am the body and the mind, that is Sakkaya Ditti.
Sakkaya Ditti.
Attachment to five khandhas is Sakkaya Ditti. Teaching five khandhas is me, myself, is Sakkaya Ditti.
Because we had read one sutta where I think two monks were talking, and then one monk said that now I know that this body is not me, I'm not this mind, but there is this sense of I.
That's a very beautiful sutta. Yeah, I don't remember the name. There, one monk is abiding, and the word spreads that he is an enlightened monk. So other monks, much elder to him, they send their emissary to him and ask questions again and again. Then he finally goes there and tells them that I'm not saying that I'm an arhant, but since I still have a scent, like the scent of a flower which remains even after the flower is gone. That is the simile he uses. And in the process of explanation of that, he becomes an arhant. That discourse says that while explaining that to his fellow monks, he becomes an arhat.
And so Sudhakar has the next question that with the understanding that the body mind is not me, would he have trouble in dealing with the world, etc., in day to day life or dealing with people?
When we see the lives of great disciples which we know of, apparently not. Of course, he will not compete to become CEO.
Yeah.
That is probably Sudhakar must be worried. But if he becomes CEO, he won't be worried about that also. So there is a story of Anath Pindakana. He was such a rich person, and a time came that he became totally pauper. Anath Pindaka, such a rich person, a time came and he became a pauper. He didn't have anything.
Yeah.
And then still he retained his equanimity, and he would go to his own monastery. And since he didn't have anything to offer, he would take some earth from his house and offer it to the trees there.
Yeah.
And in due course, again the wealth came. So the which karma will take what shape, you never know. But equanimity will be comparatively better. There's one discourse of Buddha, you know, in which Anath Pindika comes and Buddha tells him, "You look very distressed today." And I think Buddha goes to his house for food. And seeing Anath Pindika, he says, "You look very distressed today." He says, "Yes, sir, Bhante, why not? When my son is not at all following the teachings of Buddha and I'm really..."
Okay.
And then he says, "Okay, you call him." And then,
yeah. This can be the reason for distress, not the money or financial thing.
So then he tells him, calls his son, and then that discourse goes on, how he advises him and how then stories how he advises his son repeatedly, and apparently even the discourse of Buddha is not able to convince his son. Then he keeps on sending him to monastery again and again and again. Eventually the thing sinks in. Even in Vishakha's case, you know, it sounds very strange. There is a discourse in which she goes and cries and wails that my son has died, young son. She had, I think, 10 children or probably more. And so Buddha looks at her and says, "Yeah." Then she says, the passing away of a person is, you know, as usual, right? It's something which is bound to happen, but the suffering is not being caused by because somebody has died, because you are attached to this person, this body and mind as yours. That's how you're suffering. So, and would you like to have another 1,000 sons from all the family? Because they are all, if you are attached to whole of the world, then you will more suffer. So something to that effect, he says. The point I was making is that even though she was a Sutapanna, she could still feel the distress at the death of her son. So those differences, those kind of finer nuances, help us to be more compassionate to ourselves. Because otherwise we tend to whip ourselves into why we are upset after 10, 40 years of meditation.
So Sudhakar had this question, he brought it again, that you might have seen Om Prakash Ji.
Yeah, of course.
And what did you notice, possibly the reference is that?
Privilege of long interaction with him. It's very, very, very peaceful presence, very peaceful person.
Did you get any sense while talking to him that he had achieved Sotapanna?
I mean, one could feel that in his presence you feel happy.
Okay.
That was sure. Then I was very open with him. You know. Like a son, I used to ask him all kind of things. And he used to share all his experiences. And he mentioned to me that even before Vipassana, he was like that, he says. I never got worried about anything. He even got imprisoned. And he says, it's fine. For 30 days he was in prison because they thought that he was in the forest. He had gone to forest when Japanese invasion took place to protect his family. And they thought he was trying to contact them, and even though he was a very famous doctor of Burma. And I in fact even asked him, that are you showed up? He said, I don't know.
Yeah.
I had an experience of, you know, I have had experience that I sit and meditate and I just lose track of the time. So I thought I must be getting into jhanas. But apparently, Sayaji said that I've tasted Nibbana, I don't know.
What is Sayaji?
Sayaji Vakhin. Because he had meditated, he had gone to do the meditation after a long time.
Okay.
So he said, Sayaji Vakhin said that I have had experience in Nibbana, so I must be right.
Okay.
I think Sayaji didn't say it to him directly, probably. But in the city, the word went around.
Okay.
That Dr. Sahib has become a Sutta. Definitely he had a very peaceful presence.
And you had a similar experience you met Ajahn Sahib the first time.
Yeah, that was a deeper experience.
That was a much deeper experience.
Yeah. I was stunned. Because peace is something which you experience even otherwise, you know. The experience of peace, all of us have, even under normal circumstances as meditators, when you meditate for a long time, or when you are really moved by Shraddha, or any of the compassion or metta, they all give you a sense of joy and peace. But a sense of emptiness, there's nothing, that even mind is completely blanked out. When you have just come out talking to a person, is a totally, absolutely, you know, unimaginable experience. I couldn't figure out what happened.
लेकिन इससे जो शांति मिलती है वो सामान्य शांति की तरह
yeah, it's different
kind of एकदम different होती है और मतलब शुरू में शांति होती है एकदम normal उसमें आ जाती
है. When you practice meditation and you enter prasaddhi,
yes,
then you have a quietude of a different kind, definitely. But the experience of complete emptiness is a totally different thing, you know. I was taken aback. I couldn't figure out kya hua. I even told Arpan, I can't think what has happened. I wanted to say something to him about the our interaction with Ajahn Sumedho. I just couldn't say anything. I said, okay, let me sit for some time.
And sir, Silesh is further asking this question. Maybe you have already clarified, but what is the sense of emptiness when you met Ajahn Sumedho?
See, when we first met him, we had gone to request him to come to India. And he said yes, and he was just talking. He was, as usual, sharing his experiences, jokes, asking me, what do I do? I said, we're practicing and we're Burmese, and hopefully we believe that it will take many lives, and he laughed and don't believe that.
Yes.
So it was a, you know, normal chat going on. And of course he would point out certain things about tradition, about Vipassana tradition, certain things about the openness of the Thai tradition and all that. And then at the end he said, yes, I'm very happy, I will be willing to come to India. All that was going on. So we were just more interested in requesting him to come over to Delhi and doing it. So when I went out, I thought, went out of his kuti and went out. I just felt that I thought I should say something to Arpan, and I just couldn't. Mind would just refuse to think. It was as if the whole thing, brain had been cleaned off. There's nothing inside. it is totally unusual. I have never had that kind of an experience in my meditation. And I didn't, you know, normally when you practice meditation, you expect you'll get some, you'll be peaceful or happy or joyous or moved by compassion or whatever. There I didn't have any expectation. Only expectation was he agreed to come to the
end. Yeah.
And that was not virtually, that was not confirmed or anything. He didn't say yes or no.
Mm.
He left it to his assistant to tell us.
Mm.
So I was really amazed that such a thing should happen. Then I sat down on the near the office, you know, where the tea and all things were there. I sat on a bench and said, okay, I realized that something of the kind must have happened because of his presence, and I sat down quietly. And then Ajahn Ashoka came, and I didn't even get up. I didn't realize that I should get up. And then I told him, I'm sorry. And I saw Arpan getting up and sitting down, and then I told him, I am not able to think at all, you know, I don't feel like thinking at all. So he just smiled and said, yeah, yeah, this happens with people when they meet Ajahn Sumedho for the first time. And just made one comment, you know, even though he's talking, he's always abiding in emptiness.
Hmm.
So it can, infection can get into you.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. Was this a one-off experience for you, or now also when you meditate, then you
No, it was just a one-time experience.
One-time.
Yeah. No, I mean, I have been benefited by that. So that was a very amazing thing. So, that he said, it happens to many people. He said.
Mm.
So, it's okay. And then I sat down and said, no, it's all right, you can keep sitting for some more time. And then he mentioned that his limitations of his health, which we saw later.
Yeah.
He had gone with the idea that since he's going to Europe and America, I think he's going to America also, he could stop over in Delhi and then change the flight from Delhi.
So his dates for America are year end, this November something.
Ashoka has sent me some dates, I think.
Okay.
He sent all his program is fixed. He said some time in May in Amravati, and I think sometime in July or August he'll be in US.
Okay.
They have invited him for his birthday, 83rd birthday.
So Silesh is saying that is abiding in emptiness same as no ego state?
Yeah, it is only said of Arun that he abides in emptiness, nobody else.
Hmm.
In the literature, description of Arun is that he abides in emptiness. You remember when we studied the Abhidhamma, we had said there are those functional chittas with which the Arhant abides. They are wholesome, functional chittas, don't produce any kamma.
Hmm.
So that's what is meant by abiding in emptiness, that there's no sense of doership, or enjoyership or anything of that kind. Things are just happening through him. This straight sentence we find in many
suttas.
Hmm. And commentaries also, yeah.
And Sudhakar is in a lighter note saying that there goes my chance to proclaim that we are all sotapanna and don't know about it.
No, why? Chance is still there, sir. Sudhakar, you can go ahead. You can try to meet Ajahn Sumedho when he comes to US. I'll let you know the date. I think the date must be somewhere on the Forest Sangha website. His schedule must be somewhere. So I got that mail from Ajahn Ashoka. I'll forward it to
you. Silesh, is he going to California?
I think so. I'll just tell him. They are in California? I'll just check up my mail and let you know the date. says easiest part of LPS program that people can join anytime is in May at Amravati Monastery in England. He'll be there the whole month of May. Details of scheduling for trip are almost still mostly up in the air as far as public talks and everything. But on Sunday, July 23, 2107, he will be in Abhayagiri Monastery in Redwood Valley in California. I think they are also in California, no?
Yeah, so not very far. I think few hours of drive from where Salesian Sudhakar are living.
You can note it. Abhayagiri Monastery in Redwood Valley in California. Yeah. On Sunday, 23rd July, he will be there celebrating his 83rd birthday together with the abbot Ajahn Pasanno's 67th birthday.
With Ajahn?
Pasanno, who is the abbot of Abhayagiri Monastery. His 67th birthday is also seems to be on the same day. So you can note that day and
try to meet him. Both have noted.
It will be a
And Sudhakar is saying that one of our meditators has become a monk in that place.
I see. Good.
After finishing his PhD in finance.
PhD in finance. Good. So let us come up to our Pathana discussion for some time. So you will recall the conditions: Hetu Pachayo, Arambana Pachayo, Adipati Pachayo, Anantara Pachayo, Samanantara Pachayo, Sahajata Pachayo, Anyamanya Pachayo, Nisaya Pachayo, Upanisaya Pachayo, Purejata Pachayo, Pachajata Pachayo, Asevana Pachya. I think these we have done, isn't it? Asevana Pachya. Then we come to Kamma Pachya. So the condition of Kamma, let us read that. So you have done almost the half of them. Which is, let me see, which is the slide number?
It will be 72.
72. Yeah. 72. Kamma Pachaya. Kusala 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 kusalam kammam vipakanam khandanam katattar charupanam kamma pachayena pachayam. चेतना संपयुक्त कानम धम्मानम तम समर्थानानम च रूपानम कम्म पच्चेन पच्चेयो. These are the first two verses. The third one is in the next line. Okay, I think that is explaining, so let me go one by one. So what does it mean? Kushala akushala kamma. So wholesome and unwholesome kamma, vipakanam khandanam, and the resultant aggregates, vipak jo hai unka, katatta cha rupanam, and the rupas which are generated by them, kamma pachyena pachyo, they are related to that by the force of kamma condition. So kamma condition is that wholesome and unwholesome karma serve as a condition for the resulting aggregates and kamma generated matter. Then there is Chetana Sampayutta Kanam Dhammanam Tam Samutthananam Charupanam Kamma Pachayena Pachayo. Chetana means the volition, and Sampayutta Kanam Dhammanam and the associated mental states. Tam Samutthananam Charupanam and the mind generated matter. Kamma Pachayena Pachayo. They are related to them by force of Kamma condition. So this is what is meant. And these are then divided into two kinds of Kamma, as you can see from these two. First is what's called Sahajata Kamma Pachya, that is, they are arising along with this conditioning state. So for the second ones, that is the Chetana conditioned states, Chitta and Chetsika associated with these volitions. So one of the Kamma is the volition. If you recall, we had studied that volition is one of the mental universal mental factors, and along with it will arise many other mental factors. So, and Chetana being the leader, it coordinates all of that. So, Chetana is the one which conditions the states of Chittas and Chetsikas associated with those volitions. So, depending on what is the kind of volition, accordingly there will be the mental, other mental factors which will arise. You know, if it is wholesome, wholesome mental factors will arise. If it is unwholesome, unwholesome mental factors will arise. Now, they arise at the same time, no? Sahajata Pachya. So, if you see the notes, I have written them. The Sahajata Kamma is the current volition that serves as a condition for the concomitant chittas and mental states. So, this is directly in accordance with what we studied in the Abhidhamma earlier. So, because the Chetana is the volition which directs what should be, what should actually happen. And they are going to happen simultaneously with it. While the other kind of Kamma Pachya is what's called Nana Khanika. Jnana Khanika means Nana means different, Khanika means time. So things which happen at different times. So it's also called asynchronous Kamma condition. It means the past volitions produce their effect much later. So the volitions which lie dormant until the right condition is met to produce the result. So there is therefore a temporal gap between the conditioned and conditioning states. Sahajata means they arise together, but here there is a gap. So the conditioning state could be a past kushala or akushala kamma, and conditioned state will be the resultant chitta and the chetsikas and material phenomena which arise much later. They can arise at patisandhi and also at the course of existence, meaning at the time of death when the next mental consciousness goes, then it can arise. It can arise at the course of our existence. So that's what is meant by when we say fruition of kamma, karma phal jo baat kahi jati. This is what is the usual karma phala condition, which is a asynchronous condition. Now, of course, there is a big if in it. How does this asynchronous condition work? No, it doesn't really sound. And you remember I had mentioned, I had written it to Ajahn. Bhikkhu Bodhi. And then one female nun from Burmese tradition who lives in Netherlands. And this is a, you know, it's the best answer to this is, I think, found in the dialogues of Milinda. Venerable Nagsena, I have quoted it here. It kamma is not stored somewhere in this consciousness, because wo lagta hai na kamma hai kahan store kahan pe hua hai. And in fact this storing business has led to another kind of abhidhamma where they talk of stored consciousness also. But in the Theravada Abhidhamma, the explanation given is like this, that it is not stored anywhere, it is dependent on mind and matter, it rests and then manifests at the opportune time. So how does it manifest in the opportune time? So he gives the analogy that mangoes are not stored in the mango tree or in the seed of the mango. But at the appropriate time, the tree fructifies and mangoes are generated. So that is the example which is given of fruition of kamma. There is this latent tendency which remains in the consciousness stream, but it is not, it's not as if it is stored somewhere. So it is carried on with the stream of consciousness.
And what is the role of seed in that?
The volition is the seed.
Volition.
Chetana is the kamma. So the chetana with which I do action will form this seed. Mm-hmm. That will then fructify at appropriate time. So it's that reason it is said that even Arhant can have a vipaka kamma. Recall Mahamoggallana's Vipaka Kamma coming, even though he was fully enlightened and chief disciple, even then an asynchronous Kamma came over some past lives which was lying dormant, and that came over and resulted in his violent death.
पर इसमें आता है जब अरहंत बन जाते हैं
जी
तब आता है कोई
yeah. This is what happened with Mahamoggallana na. Still the
उसका result karma, क्या हुआ फिर?
That he died at the, he was killed by the robbers.
अच्छा
robbers or whosoever, there are different stories who killed him, but
अच्छा
but he had that psychic power to get alive again. They cut his body into pieces और उनकी इतनी पावर थी उन्होंने शरीर को फिर जोड़ लिया, फिर जिंदा हो गए.
अच्छा
फिर वो तीसरी बार उनको काट के उसको जला भी दिया था, भस्म ही बना दी. देन अगेन देन ही गॉट अ चांस टू आई थिंक रिफ्लेक्ट एंड सॉ दैट इट वाज अ फ्रक्टिफिकेशन ऑफ हिज पास्ट कर्मा एंड देयरफॉर ही शुड नॉट रेजिस्ट इट. सो ही वेंट टू द बुद्धा, प्रोजेक्टेड हिमसेल्फ बिफोर द बुद्धा, सॉट हिज ब्लेसिंग्स एंड पास्ट अवे. So the kammas, that's why they are classified in various categories, you know, weighty kamma or habitual kamma or death threshold kamma or reserve or effective kamma.
So फिर शरीर रहता नहीं है लेकिन उनका जो चेतना है उसके आधार पर उन्होंने वो किया,
जो उनके चित्त में चित्त के अंदर जो एक दुष्कर्म कभी किया था, जो बहुत विच इज ए वेटी कर्म, किलिंग योर फादर एंड मदर. वेटी कर्म विच विल प्रोड्यूस इट्स इफेक्ट इरेस्पेक्टिव ऑफ व्हाट यू डू.
वो मर गए मतलब, फिर उसके बाद जो उनका चेतना थी
नहीं, वो तो अरहंत हो गए थे. देन ही वाज लिबरेटेड, फ्रीड फ्रॉम साइकिल ऑफ बर्थ.
शरीर वो जब काट दिया उसके बाद
एक दो बार उन्होंने उसको अपनी साइकिक पावर से दोबारा उसको जीवित कर लिया था, बट देन ही रियलाइज दैट इट इज फ्रक्टिफिकेशन ऑफ दैट कर्मा. He didn't want that these people who are killing him, they should get into such a serious problem of having killed Arhant. Because yeah, killing an Arhant is a terrible thing. See the compassion of the person. They will get into trouble because of killing an Arhant. So he just used his psychic powers to become alive again. And to Buddha, and give up his body. So such kammas are very weighty kammas. The habitual kammas are which we do as a routine matter. Death threshold kamma means the one which we remember at the time of the death. Some kamma which comes at the time and which has a strong influence on the next life. And the effective kammas are those which are reserved, and they would not. If there is no other karma which is available at the time of death, then they will produce an impact and give it next birth. So it's not necessary that we always say that the death threshold karma may arise. One may have a get into it as kind of coma or some such thing where the consciousness is very much deeply impaired. Then the reserve karma, whatever he has done in the lifetime, will take its precedence and give rise to the next birth. So that is the kamma paccaya. Then we have next one, vipaka paccaya. Vipaka means the effect, kamma vipaka. So they are quite related to each other. But vipaka paccaya has a very limited jurisdiction. So let me read out. चत्तारो खंदा अरूपिनो अन्यमन्यम विपाक पच्चयेन पच्चय. चत्तारो खंदा द फोर खंदा अरूपिनो विच इज अदर देन द रूपा. सो द फोर रिजल्टेंट मेंटल एग्रीगेट्स अन्यमन्यम विपाक पच्चय. अन्यमन्यम यू रिमेंबर वाज द रेसिप्रोसिटी कंडीशन, दे आर रिलेटेड टू ईच अदर बाय दैट ऑल्सो. विपाक पच्चय ऑल्सो एंड रेसिप्रोकटी कंडीशन ऑल्सो. सो वट इज पॉइंट टू पॉइंट आउट इज दैट द फोर नाम खंदाज the vedana, sanya, sankhara and vijnana, they serve as a vipaka paccaya to each other and also to the associated rupas and the chittas which arise along with them. So they are all also having, they are the result of vipaka, kamma vipaka. What vedana we get is a result of kamma vipaka, and that is the reciprocity with the sanya and sankhara and vijnana. So the
one can affect other.
दे आर म्यूचुअली रेसिप्रोकल, यू नो, वन विल अराइज द अदर विल ऑल्सो अराइज टूगेदर विद देम. यू रिमेंबर दे अन्य मन्य पच्चे हेड सेट, यू नो, दे आर साइमल्टेनियसली अराइजिंग एंड इन्फ्लुएंसिंग ईच अदर इन अ वे. So you can, I think, read the notes which I have written here. The you know, these vipaka chittas are passive, so they are the, being the fruits of the kamma, and they are quiescent, and they make the conditioned state also passive and quiescent. Thus, in the mind of a person in deep sleep, the resultant bhavanga chitta arises and passes away, and there is not even the distinct awareness of any object. Similarly, in the five-door cognitive process, the resultant chittas do not make any effort to know their object. It is only in the jhavana phase that the effort is made to clearly cognize the object. You remember those 17 mind movements and all that. And thereafter actions are performed. Vipaka chitta and its accompanying chetsika also condition one another by way of conescence condition and by way of mutuality condition. So now we can see as we are progressing that a particular conditioning dhamma can influence the conditioned dhamma in variety of ways. Here it is vipaka pachyo, also annyamanya pachyo, also sahajata pachyo. So they are all happening simultaneously. So there are always more than one cause and more than one effect. That kind of a fact is brought out by the pathana also. Then we come to the next one, ahara pachyo. Ahara is normally, in Hindi also we know, food or nutriment. So, kavalikaro aharo imasya kayasya ahara pachyena pachya. Arupino ahara sampayutta kanam dhammanam tam samutthananam charupanam ahara pachyena pachya. And in the next slide also there is the third part of it. Arupino ahara sampayutta kanam dhammanam tam samutthananam charupanam ahara pachyena pachya. So, let's see them one by one. So, kavalikaro means the in this form of a sphere, ball. So it is like a morsel. I think in that time, I think even now, people, when they take rice, they make it into a small ball and then eat it. So kavalikaro aharo means that kind of physical food. Basically, it means physical food. Imasya kayasya, of this body, ahara pachyena pachyo. So this physical food acts as a nutriment for this body, which is quite obvious. It conditions the rupas of the body by ahara pachya. Arupino ahara sampayutta kanang dhammanang tam samutthananang charupana ahara pachyena pachya. Then there are arupino ahara, means aharas which we take, which nutriment which we get, which is not physical, which is not material. What are those arupina aharas? You remember, we had mentioned it once earlier. Bhasa, chetana and vinyana. First means the contact of the senses with the world around, that acts as a nutriment. Then the volition acts as a nutriment because it changes the rupas, and the vinyana which arises. So there, the meaning is that mental condition is a nutrition is a condition for their associated mental factors, and the matter produced thereby by the force of nutrition condition. So what we see is that in the case of ahara pachyo, ahara is a conditioning dhamma, and it supports the growth and development of the conditioned dhamma, which is a universal common statement here. And the last of them is arupino ahara. How do the arupino ahara they? Sampayutta kanam dhammanam tam samutthananam charupanam ahara pachyena pachyo. So the let's look at that statement again, which is there, no? Second statement. That is, mental nutrition is caused condition for the associated mental factors. So I have written it in detail here. It's this detailed exposition on the second. Here the conditioning factors are the phassa, chetana and consciousness, as I mentioned. And what are the conditioning factors? All the possible consciousness and all the possible mental factors. 89 consciousness and 52 mental factors. So they are all influenced by the ahara. And conditioning mode is that this is what is meant by ahara pachya. So the physical nutriment is influencing the physical body, एंड मेंटल न्यूट्रीमेंट इज इन्फ्लुएंसिंग नॉट ओनली द मेंटल स्टेट्स बट ऑल्सो द फिजिकल बॉडी दे आर ऑल्सो तम समुत्थानानंच रूपानं द रूपाज विच अराइज अलॉन्ग विद दोज मेंटल स्टेट्स सो वी कैन सी इंट्यूटिवली हाउ दीज थ्री हस चेतना एंड विज्ञान आर ऑल्सो a type of nutriment, a type of food which we get from the surroundings, isn't it? Because when we interact with the world through senses, there is a contact with the world. And that sense context influences our mental structure and also influences our bodily structure. We know that. You see something which is attractive, body is something. If you see something which is fearful, something else will happen in the body. So, therefore, pasa is also seen as a nutriment. Then chetana, of course, is the coordinator, is the leader of the mental factors. And the way chetana emerges, that will influence all our body and mind states. And vijnana, of course, being the chitta, being the king of the whole mind states. Without vijnana, chitta or chetsikas cannot arise. So therefore, chitta is supporting and maintain these accompanying chitsikas.
Shilesh has this question, sir. Doesn't food also influence mind?
The food will influence mind through the secondary impacts. The food which we eat will cause an effect on the body, and our response to that body effect will influence our mind. So here it is, I think the point is being made is immediate contact, the next immediate influence.
And of course by seeing the food, there will be contact.
There will be a contact.
That will be part of this mind.
Yeah, very right. When you see the food, when you touch, because it's going to touch at various sense doors.
Yeah.
So there the mental factors will come. You know, we see the food and we don't like it, or we taste it and we don't like it. So those things will influence our body because of the associated rupas which arise. Okay. Then we come to the indriya pachaya. Indriya is the word used for leader. Indra, the leader actually means strength, or you can also say the leader or the controlling principle, because we say five indriya in other tradition, or six faculties we call them, because they control our life completely. So in that sense they are called indriyas. So the relationship of indriyas is being explained in this parchaya. चक्षु इंद्रियं चक्षु विज्ञान धातुया तन संपयुक्त कानं च धम्मानं इंद्रिय पच्चयेन पच्चयो सिमिलरली फॉर ऑल अदर इंद्रिया श्रोत इंद्रिया घान इंद्रिया एंड सो ऑन देन रूप जीवित इंद्रियानं कटट्टस्य रूपानं इंद्रिय पच्चयेन पच्चयो सो दीज आर द टू एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ इट वन इज दैट चक्षु इंद्रियानं सदि आई फैकल्टी चक्षु विज्ञान धातुया इज अ कंडीशन एंड condition for the chakhu vinyana dhatu, that is eye consciousness element, and tam sampatthanam cha rupam dhammanam, and the associated dhammas which arise together with, they are related by the indriya pachaya, indriya condition. Similarly for ear, nose, tongue, body and so on. Then rupa jivita indriyanam, this rupa jivita, you remember jivita indriya is the life faculty which supports the life. And Rupa Jivita Indriya means the one which supports the physical body. Rupa Jivita Indriyanam Katatta Ache Rupanam, and the Kamma born by that Indriya Pachyena Pachyaya. So physical life faculty is a condition for Kamma born matter by that Pachyaya of Indriya. So you can see in the notes I have put down the conditioning Dhamma. Pachyaya Dhamma is the Chakhu Rupa, and conditioned Dhamma is the Chakhu Vinyana. Similarly for all other sense doors, for all other sense spaces. So the when you say the Katatta Rupa, it means the Rupa which arises as a result of Kamma done in the past. So these are, regarding the Indriyas, there is a lot of discussion found in the suttas as well as in the Abhidhamma and the commentary literature. The indriyas are basically, as I have put down in the notes, called to be of three broad classifications. One is Pure Jata Indriya. In the notes, if you open the notes, then they can see that. Pure Jata Indriya, then Rupa Jivita Indriya and Sahajata Indriya. So Pure Jata means that which has arisen earlier. Now, because of the difference between the time duration of Rupa element and mental element, if you remember, Rupa element is 17 mind moments. Because of that, the previously arisen Rupa can be influenced by subsequently arisen mental states also. So the what is happening every moment, we say the body, the Rupa elements are arising and passing away. So if they are passed away, how do they arise again? By Rupa Jivita Indriya. It is that Rupa Jivita Indriya which creates a constant replacement, and we are able to arrive, live for a reasonable length of time and not just one mind moment or one Rupa moment. And it is the momentum of that comes from the kamic energy. So at the time of our Patisandhi, when you are born, there is a certain kamic energy which gives momentum to the Jivita Indriya, and depending on that will be our lifespan. So it is our kamic energy that generates such a constant process of generic materials signifying what we are. These genetic physical elements are preserved or sustained by the physical life faculty of Rupa Jivita Indriya. Then we come to the third one. Arupino indriya sampayutta kanan dhammana tam samutthananam cha rupanam indriya pachyena pachyo. So what is it? Here we are talking of arupino means non-physical. Because there are non-physical material, non-material faculties. Sampayutta kanan cha dhammana and the associated dhammas, associated mental factors. Tam samutthananam cha rupanam and the rupas which arise together with, they are related by indriya pachya. So the translation I have written down here, mental faculties are a condition for the mental factors which are associated with them and the matter which is produced thereby by the force of faculty condition. So in our suttas you generally find five indriyas mentioned, you know, saddha, virya, panya and sati. In the commentorial literature and in Abhidhamma, they talk of 20 indriyas. They include other things also in the indriyas, which I have put down in the notes on this slide, if you kindly look at it. So the five indriyas which are mentioned in the suttas are Sati Indriya, Saddha Indriya, Virya, Samadhi and Panya. But in the Abhidhammic literature, you have others also. Somanasya Indriya or Somanasya Vedana Chetsika, Domanasya Indriya or Domanasya Vedana Chetsika, Sukhindriya or Sukha Vedana Chetsika, Dukhindriya or Dukha Vedana Chetsika, Upekha Indriya or Upekha Vedana Chetsika. Now, why are these being said? Because the Vedana, that is the mental feelings and the physical feelings arising from bodily feelings, they all also have a very strong influence on us. So that's why in this literature, they are also termed as indriyas. So if we have a painful feeling, you know, we know how much strong influence it has on our mind and the whole of our life behavior. So that's why in this literature, these are also termed as indriyas. So these indriyas serve as faculty condition for their consciousness born or chitta jarupa. So that's quite a bit of a surprise, because normally we in suttas don't read of Vedana being an indriya. We talk only of those five proper indriyas. So these are those small additions which have been done in the literature later. Okay, so I think we'll stop here. I will take up the Jhana Pachya and others later. Just taking up too many at a time. creates difficulty in assimilating. So what we studied today, let me just recall quickly. Kamma Pachya we studied, then we studied Vipaka Pachya, and then we studied Ahara Pachya. And finally, Indriya Pachya. So these are the four things which we studied today. Now as we progress and towards the conclusion, you can see how the multiple relationships arise. You can have Indriyas which are arising simultaneously because Vedana will arise simultaneously with the Chitta. So you have Sahajata Indriya, you have Purajata Indriya. So all these complications begin to emerge as we study the mind processes in greater detail. If there are any questions from friends, we can take. Otherwise, say goodbye.
Sir Sudhakar wants to know about your experience of Arunachala.
Good, I think first 3 days I was a bit uncomfortable with the rituals and pujas and chantings going on. I continued to meditate in my own way, the way we meditate. And I was reflecting on this issue of the Sotapatti Marga as given by, you know, there's a book published by Abhayagiri Monastery on the island, you know. Which details about the Nibbana and the Sotapatti steam entry. And I realized that when you read Anatta Lakkhana Sutta, what is it actually asking, Buddha asking us to do? To inquire into what is the nature of self. That when we take body as self, mind as self, Vedana as self, and all the five skandhas as self, they are not self because of these reasons. So, me, it seemed that the inquiry into the nature of self is what Ramana Maharshi must also have been doing. There's no way to find out what he was doing. He would only say, inquire, sit and inquire. Let the mind quieten down and sit and inquire. So that's what it seemed to me. But apparently some of my friends didn't like that. they felt that it was being... I was advocating that you should go to Advaita and this and that. It was not that all the intention. Intention was to point out that things are not, that all other traditions are not deluded as we generally tend to believe. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a problem with Vipassana meditators. They become dogmatic.
Everything black and white.
Yeah, they become dogmatic about things. They're not able to pick up the right things from everywhere, but they want to label things and just put them aside. And that has been, since we have been exposed to teachings of Jan Sumedho and all, we can see that it's not a black and white kind of thing. The exposition which Jan Sumedho gives of Anidhasana Vijnana and consciousness being always present and one, it's very much in tune with that. So, the feeling at the end of that period was that it's not that Advaita people are all deluded as we generally used to believe. One can be deluded as a Vipassana meditator
exactly
also.
Exactly, I was going to say that. It is the same with Vipassana meditators as well, that they can be deluded.
We have a huge number of Vipassana meditators who get deluded by their experiences.
Exactly.
So that, you know, that rigidity and dogmatism, it virtually bothers on, you know, borders on fanaticism. There's nobody else can be enlightened other than one who follows the path. Partly it arises because of poor translation also, I always wonder. Because the word Ekai no Maggo has been translated by VRI as the only path.
The only path.
Which is wrong translation. Ekai no Maggo means, Ekai no means the direct path. It is, you have to see any Pali dictionary, you have to see any other translation. Nowhere in the world, any other scholar or monk or any person has translated Ekaino as the only. all translated as the direct path. The Buddha himself gave so many paths.
Different people. Yes.
Would tell them different things.
Yes.
But somehow we want to conflate everything and say, no, it's all this. All this is just the same one particular thing.
Right.
Even if you study Sahaja Yuvak in, I don't know if you studied Sahaja Yuvak in German. There is an essay of him that Vipassana can be practiced in variety of ways.
Yes.
You can practice Vipassana on each of the sense doors.
Yes.
And this method of bodily observation is just one of them.
Exactly.
So how can you then say that those who practice others are deluded? Sad thing. That's a kind of delusion which arises because of attachment to the raft. As Buddha said it, the raft is for deliverance, not for grasping and holding on to.
Right.
So we hold on to a raft and use that raft to
be others. But I think it's a part problem of that, of course, we've got this good teaching and this so powerful teaching. But we ourselves are not able to really practice it so well. So intellectually we think that, okay, holding on to this raft is at least something that we are doing, and I stick to that. I think it's because of that.
That also is the reason.
Because the more you practice, the more you open up, and then the more you see how are the things also put in.
The key issue which in our group we have been discussing for now how many 5 years is this issue of anatta, not trying to give due importance to that. And therefore, all our practice becomes based on anatta. I am the one who is doing the practice and I have to work hard. In the beginning, it's very important.
Right.
But if we continue to do that, we will be trapped. We can never enter the stream. Because entering the stream means giving up the notion of I.
Right.
So this is what has been pointed out by the Thai tradition, very powerful, the Thai forest tradition of Ajahn Chah and Ajahn Sumedho and others. So that has been a great blessing to all of us.
So Silesh has this question that Dr. Plishman says we should not meditate with meditators from other traditions as the subtle energy is different.
Yeah,
any thoughts?
Maybe. I don't have any opinions on that. It may be. But there was nobody meditating there. They were all doing other things and I was sitting in a corner and meditating. There may be, of course, there must be some difference. But I don't believe that, because when you see the teachings of Ramana Maharshi, his entirely teaching is, I am not the body, not the mind, not the intellect. That is the key teaching. So I don't see how it is different. Now, whether they meditate in this way or that way, whether they are sitting properly or not, whether they are observing breath or not, whether they are observing body sensations or not, to me, that is of much lesser consequence. The key thing, key teaching is, I am not the body, not the mind, not the intellect, which is exactly what the Buddha is saying. There's no distinction there. Really. So, if you go to a place where the key teaching is about the notion of a supreme creator who is creating you and doing all the things, or that you have to pay, devotion means that you have to depend entirely on the somebody to
liberate you,
and obviously there will be confusion. But one has to have that clarity in it. One has to have clarity on what the teaching is. Reason I went was out of respect for this. Long back, 30 years ago, we had studied Vedanta in great detail and not understood it and dismissed it entirely as a speculative mental exercise. And now I could see it's not a mental exercise, it's not an intellectual exercise. It's an exercise in discovery, it's an exercise in deep introspection. Because I always wondered, how can a person, if you read the life of Ramana Maharshi, you wonder, how can such a person be, we can term as a deluded person, that he doesn't know what he is doing. It's amazing.
There is the tendency.
You have to read his life, गो एंड सी विजिट प्लेसेस मीट पीपल हु हैव बीन डायरेक्टली इन्फ्लुएंस्ड बाय हिम रीड देयर लाइव्स
बट इज दैट अ टेंडेंसी ऑफ पीपल लेबलिंग हिम एज डिल्यूडेड
आई मीन आवर ट्रेडिशन एंटायरली ऑलवेज टॉक्स अबाउट दैट in the mail which Sudhakar is referring to effectively it was said that they are lost in a Michha Samadhi
okay.
I mean this word was used it's quite sad Michha Samadhi means that you are doing wrong things you are not in Samma Samadhi
yeah Basically, in the normal sense, Sanatana Dharma, those people used to call him as not doing proper meditation or Michha Samadhi.
Who?
But the normal priest or...
No, they couldn't understand what he was doing.
Okay.
The story is that when he, as an age of 16, he became enlightened according to his experience. And he just left home and went to the... Arunadi Thiruvanmalai because of the tradition there that Arunachala is a very holy place and auspicious place. And he used to sit in the temple there because he didn't go to the hill first and just be deeply absorbed. And the children would throw stones at him and I don't know, do whatever they liked. And he just didn't respond. He was deeply absorbed in his own meditation. And it took quite some time for people to realize, some saints to come and realize that he is a person of a different kind. He is not a mad person or something of that kind. But the painful thing is to see meditators also mentioning that. It's sad.
So, sir, relevant to present discussion, Sudhakar has pointed a link to a podcast and wants us to play for a few minutes.
Yeah.
So, I'll just play it right now. Good.
Or if you more or temperament of a jnani, of them, they will look, say, but everything that is seen requires the seer. Everything that is perceived requires the perceiving of it. Who is the I? Can I itself, who says I perceive, can it be perceived? And you have to think right there and don't ask another question. This type of inquiry, you don't have 2, 3, 4 questions now. All your questions boil down to one question. Everything that is perceived from any time frame, any person, it must be some phenomena, some quality. And the perceiver of this quality is where? Where is the location of that? And who are you in that in relation to that location? Are you different or similar? Are you also one of the objects seen, or are you the seer of all things? And if you have the feeling, I'm the seer of all things, then your position is already qualified. Now you ask the question, can this seer also be seen? I don't think you need another question after this question. I said before, this is a final question. You cannot exchange it for another question. You exchange it for another question, means you turn back, you're going somewhere else, you're going off course. Everything will bring you to this point. If somebody say, I don't trust you, I don't believe anything you say. You say, yeah, answer my question. You don't have to trust me or believe me. I have asked this question, follow this question. I dare you, if you are true. I'm not seeking relationship with you. I give you a question. I feel this question is probably the highest question in the universe. For the one who wants to see. because I brought this question now, then some will hate me for this question and some will love me for this question. But greatest is the one who will take this question. Some will hate you because you have now brought everything, say, okay, fine, where is your excuse? No. And that part of their mind, the devil part of the mind, which wants to keep you tied onto this body and into this earth only, and will not let you go, is the biggest mafia in the existence. He doesn't let go of anybody. You have to break free. No use saying to the mind, please, please let me go, I'll be very good. No, he's not going to let you go. You have to break free. One who breaks free is called a Buddha, or Christ, or something like this. Sometimes the beings, they don't want to hear, they don't want to hear. It's not even the beings that don't want to hear. It's their relationship, their false with pseudo relationship, formed with the ego, don't want to know this question. It's too powerful a question. They will tell you, give me 15 steps to freedom. I say, I don't want to give you any step. You step aside. Let one who really want to know, let this one come. So it depends if you are someone who just listen to your mind, and all of us for a while we are going to listen to our minds. It is just like that. But for freedom, you have to somehow come to see that the mind came after you, not original.
Okay, so let me stop here. I'll share the full link.
What is this? I think, is it Muji probably?
Muji
hai to hai.
It's written.
So what was Sudhakar's point in asking us to play this? What was this Sudhakar's comment?
Yeah, he's saying Muji. You're just pointing to the reference that from Ramana Mahashri, Punyaji, and from Punyaji to Muji. And I think the relevant part was this, again, that question about self-inquiry, which we were discussing. And I think that's a reference which Sudhakar made. And of course, he's typing. So. Sudhakar, is that right? He's saying yes.
See, one, if you read Anatta Lukkhana Sutta, what does Buddha tell them? Let me see if you can open it. Access to website me milega, na? Access to insight me.
Aapka CVD padha hua tha. Aap
है कुछ स्लाइड है आपके पास
आपने हमने पढ़ा हुआ ना सर
हाँ पढ़ा तो हुआ है बट मेरे को एक्सेस नहीं है मेरे पास आई कैन जस्ट सी इट अगेन फ्रॉम द एक्सेस टू वेबसाइट में मिल जाएगा इट्स इम्पोर्टेंट सूत्र सो इट मस्ट बी देयर तुम भी खोल लो उससे एक्सेस से
मुज्जू जी ने भी उपासना की थी क्या
It says, I have heard that on one occasion, Blessed One was saying that form, monks, is not self. If form were the self, this form would not lend itself to disease. It would be possible to say, with regard to form, let this be form, let this form not be this. But precisely because form is not self, form itself lent to disease. Of course, there are preceding things. I think they have shortened it down. What do you think, monks? Is form permanent, impermanent, unsatisfactory, satisfactory, subject to change, not subject to change? And so, what is subject to change? What is impermanent? Can it be treated as myself? What is all this? This is inquiry. What else is inquiry? Mm-hmm. This is inquiry you're trying to ask. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, if you say, no, this is not to be done,
yes. Well,
good luck to you. What can I say? This inquiry into nature of everything. So one cannot just blindly keep on mechanically observing the bodily sensations and feel that some miracle will happen and I'll be enlightened. You have to inquire this. Unless we inquire, you won't be able to break through. So what exactly the other people do, I don't know. I'm not bothered about it, but I don't see any reason to think that a person who does inquiry of this kind is a heretic or something else, or deluded, or Michha Samadhi or Michha Ditti. It's a sad thing. It's a kind of dogma which is going on. That's it. That's the way it is. What can you do? You can only try to point out. Is that okay, Sudhakar? Any other comment? What is your independent opinion? You're a very senior meditator.
Please type in.
Ajit.
He's saying, sir, sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Sudhakar is a very senior meditator. I think he's done a large number of long courses.
Okay, anything else? Else we'll close the session for the day. He's saying absolutely right.
Good.
And he's saying,